on the 2nd of October. I just want to start by saying a couple of words about what I believe is at the root of our difficulties in terms of how we come at European treaties in general, how we come at the issue of the use of Shannon. And it's around how we define neutrality in Ireland. And this is an old debate, I'm sure, for many, but it's still a critical one. Time after time, when Irish public opinion is tested as to what the understanding of neutrality is, the public prove that they have a very rooted and considered view of what's called active neutrality. Irish public opinion understands neutrality to mean our positioning in terms of foreign affairs, international relations, alliances or the lack of them, and of course what we do with our troops or our military hardware. Irish people, public opinion, understands that neutrality is not simply just about what you do with troops, that it actually involves a whole lot more. But it seems to me, and it's been proven, that there's a gap between the public understanding of neutrality, the active neutrality that the people want and support on the one hand, and the definition in the political class of what neutrality is and what neutrality means. Because for the government, and in fact for all of the larger political parties in this state, neutrality is simply about the deployment of troops. And that is why every time we attempt to have a discussion or debate on the issue of neutrality, a spokesperson for the government or for Fine Gael or for the Labour Party pops up and says, ah yes, but we have the triple lock. You can predict it. I'm sure all of you have seen this happening. Irish troops cannot go anywhere without the express permission of government, of the Dáil, and in accordance with the UN Charter. We could all write the script on that. And that mechanism, that triple lock, has been used really by government and by the political system to sidestep the fundamental debate that we need to have. I believe that they won't open up this debate with the people because they understand that public opinion has a far more advanced understanding and appreciation of neutrality than the political class do. And so when, for instance, my own party, Sinn Féin, brought forward a bill in the Dáil asking that we go to referendum and actually define this thing called neutrality in the 1937 constitution in Bunrock na hÉireann, all of the champions of neutrality from Fianna Fáil and Fine Gael and so on said no thank you. And they said no thank you because they don't want that kind of discussion and that kind of definition. I think one of the enduring problems with the European project from an Irish perspective has been the damage that successive treaties have done to any notion we may have of ourselves as a neutral. And I'm mindful of what Ed said in the previous session in describing events here at Shannon. But nonetheless, the public and political understanding of our position as a state is that we are nominally, at least, neutral. Time and again when EU treaties are debated, but particularly since the Single European Act, the Crotty Judgment and the emergence of referendums in this state, time and again the issue of neutrality has raged in debates on the European project. So, let me just say a few words then about Lisbon against all of that. The Lisbon Treaty unquestionably cuts the legs from under what remains of Ireland's neutral position. It does so in a number of ways. Most obviously in Article 28, where it asks of commitments to a deepening relationship with NATO. It asks for commitments to increase military spending. The treaty asks for a mutual defence arrangement and a solidarity clause. The treaty expands very significantly the type of military operations that the EU can undertake. The treaty allows for almost mini military alliances. It's called permanent structured cooperation. But what it means is that small groups of member states can forge ahead and take on what are called the more ambitious military missions. Read into that what you will. All of that is in the Lisbon Treaty. Now, I think on any understanding of the neutral position of Ireland, for Ireland, even the narrow definition of military neutrality is violated by each of those provisions. But there's more, because the Lisbon Treaty equally envisages that there shall be a common defence. Shall be. So we have moved from a position where there was speculation around there might be, there may be, there can be a common defence, now into the territory of there shall be when the Council decides. And that's a very significant shift. The government will tell you, well, there has to be a referendum in this state on that matter. Well, be that as it may, at what point do we decide that we have now entered into the common defence? Who'll define the moment at which this common defence has emerged? It seems to me that there is a big issue there. It seems to me the realpolitik of this will be that the government will go along with all of the provisions of Lisbon and the previous treaties, and then we wake up one morning, maybe to hear that we're having a referendum, and I can tell you what the political line of argument will be for those of us who will argue against a common defence. They'll say, sure, we're involved in all of this already.
Yeah. Yeah.
So that's why I raise that issue. I raise that issue not to nitpick the treaty as we've been accused of, but simply to say watch the language, because they're legal texts and the language is very, very important. The Lisbon Treaty also signs Ireland up explicitly and unequivocally to a common foreign policy. Not alone that, the treaty also envisages the emergence of what would be a European Minister for Foreign Affairs. It has some other strange title, but that's what it would be, and a diplomatic service. Now, for those of us who argue for active, real neutrality, we're not wimps, we're not people who believe that you stand idly by and let the world's wrongs wash over you. We believe in a vigorous, in a courageous position by our country on the international stage. We do not want our state or our nation co-opted to the agenda of the big boys. We do not simply want to hitch our wagon onto NATO and hope that things will work out okay. We take our international responsibilities far more seriously than that. And those of us who argue for that position know full well that you cannot sign up to a common foreign policy and a common defence policy and a deeper relationship with NATO and live with the delusion that you still enjoy a neutral status. That is not possible. More importantly, and I finish on this because Michael's about to bang, maybe throw the jug at me. More importantly than that, you cannot be co-opted into that agenda and go along that particular route and imagine at the same time that this country, this proud nation, this nation that knows about colonialism and occupation and partition, this country that should play a courageous, a brave and progressive role on the international stage. We can't do that and we won't do that if we simply allow the Lisbon agenda and treaty to go through. So for those reasons, Michael, and there's more, I'm sure we'll get to discuss it, it is critically important that on the 2nd of October, This state returns a no vote. Gurimi Lamar.